Thank you, Todd. There are a lot of buzzwords in the title. I'll dissect them one by one as we go into the talk. About me, a lot of my time is spent in performance analysis and trying to bring down Amazon servers, not in production, but our test servers, and understanding where they can fail and designing mechanisms to provide that to prevent that failure. To start with, what is a circuit breaker? I hope everybody here knows that. It comes from electrical engineering background. It's basically a device which stops electrical current. It stops electric current from flowing into your equipment in case there is a power surge or your electrical equipment is drawing too much current. So the aim is to protect your equipment from failing. Similarly, here we are going to use that same mechanism to protect our web servers. Next is, what is a microservice? I'll not go into depth of explaining those. I'll take an example. Assume you have a bookstore e-commerce website, which is incidentally what Amazon started with. I took some four components that could define your website: users, orders, books, and payments. How would you develop it in the first go? You'd have everything running on your server, and all of these apps will communicate to each other because they are on the same server. They don't need any specialized form of communication. What is the disadvantage? This is called a monolithic based model. What are the disadvantages of this model? Of course, if you are a team of 100 people working on a same server, things are going to get messy. You're not going to know who's doing what at what time. Second thing is how your APIs work. Any small change in users will need to be consumed accordingly in all of your other apps. Other things could be deploying this whole system is going to take a lot of time. It's going to be a lot of code sitting at one piece, and every time you have to deploy this whole system in your server, and assume you have a bug in, say, one of your apps, then your whole server is going to not respond. Then we go towards the microservices based model. Here, same thing, we have a main web application which is going to serve your users, but at the same time, the way it talks to all the services is using HTTP, and they don't reside on the same server. So what would be the advantage of this would be same, the disadvantages we discussed in this monolithic model. All of these components are independently deployable. You can just have a new instance spin up for books if books is getting too much load. Similarly, other things could be, if your book service is probably down due to some issue, all the remaining services can still work and your website can still partially work. So this is a very simple introduction to what a microservices model would be like. And this would be a model that I'll take in the slides. There'll be a main web application which is going to be fronting your customers, and it would be talking to a few microservices. I'll start with a few principles on how would you design a cloud-based application or a microservices-based application. The main point to stress here is to design for failures. That is the first thing that should be in your mind. When there is a business like an e-commerce business, designing for failures becomes a requirement instead of something good to have. Taking an example, a 20-minute outage on just Amazon.com is going to cost the company $3.75 million. So that's a lot of money. Some principles on how I would approach designing for failures. So the first two points are supposedly obvious. Do not fail if your microservice goes down, and application should not forever keep waiting for your microservice to respond. So if you think about it for a little while, you'll figure out, okay, yeah, we can just use a timeout in our application to be able to do this. So nothing big deal here. So next would be three points which are not very obvious, but they are very, very critical. So the first is to contain and isolate failures. What do I mean by contain failures is, if your one microservice is down or it is facing some latency issues, not all of your users should be affected. You'll need to, this is not just related to microservices, it's related to any cloud-based model. Not all your users should be impacted by outages. That should be your best effort. Respect the service when it is slow. So when you own, say, when your company owns hundreds of microservices and one of them is not responding, your application should be smart enough to not bombard that service with millions of requests. Finally, your company owns that microservice and you're not helping by sending a lot of requests to it. You're just making things worse. Last is fail fast, recover fast, which is the principle behind the circuit breaker model. So of course, if you have used electric circuit breakers, there, how do you solve your problems? You figure out, okay, something is wrong, then you call an electrician, he does the checking. If everything is fine, he turns back the current. In this case, you cannot do that. Not every time somebody can go and turn on your application once your microservices recover. That should be an automated process and it should be as fast as is possible. So I'll take an example of a simple multi-threaded web app. If you haven't worked with a lot of languages like Java, you wouldn't have seen it, but it is not very complicated. So how this application works is, this has two microservices, users and books, and this is your main web application. There are a set of requests that come in from users to the web application. There is a dedicated HTTP thread pool here, which we can ignore for this talk. It is just because it has there is somebody who is supposed to manage the lower level connections, and there's an application thread pool. What is the application thread pool? It basically takes in your request and computes the response that it is supposed to send to the user. And at the same time, it asynchronously calls users and books. Of course, you don't need a call to books to fail if users is taking too much time. So you do it at the same time asynchronously. Now some numbers here. So we are gonna do some math here, but it's gonna be very simple eighth grader math. So the same web application, some numbers that are from a real world case that we had. Average latency of a service is say 100 milliseconds. The timeout that we keep for these services is 1 second. How do we get this timeout? Simply the SLA for the team who owns the service decides the SLA. Request per second, that is the incoming request to your server, that is 100. And application threads are 100 to start with. That is a very decent number. We actually had it in production for a lot of time without any issues, and we could serve a lot more than 100 requests. So what happens when the user service is unavailable? What is unavailable? It might be very, very slow, or might not respond at all. We send a request to it and we are gonna time out based on the timeout we had. So some questions here. I'm gonna run through some math here, very simple math. So I would need some attention. So what would be the average latency of an incoming request? So the minimum, we don't know the average here. What would be the minimum latency in this case? The user service is going to fail after 1 second, that is the timeout. So at least 1 second is needed for every request to go through. So that would be the minimum latency. Average latency would of course be larger than 1 second. Your application still needs to compute the response. Also, we are assuming that book service responds fairly fast. So not a lot of issue from the book service, but we are gonna compute and create a response for the user. So it's probably gonna take more than 1 second overall. What would be the request served received by the dependent service, the user service? Of course, we didn't have any guardrail here to check, oh, user service is not available, so we shouldn't send it a request. So we did send all the requests that came into our application to the user service. Now, this is an interesting point. Request per second that your application can serve. Remember, we had an application thread pool size of 100 threads. So simply assume 100 requests came in at the same time, which can be a real world case, to the application thread pool. And all 100 threads in the application thread pool are going to be busy calling the user service. So your whole application thread pool is used for this 1 second timeout. So you cannot serve anything more than 100 requests. And you are not even going to be able to serve 100 requests, because as soon as you time out after 1 second, you're still gonna need to do some work. So you're not gonna be able to serve the incoming request per second of 100. While your application thread pool was designed to serve, say, 400 requests in a happy case. Assume a case, a simple case. You just wanted to browse books on the page. The user service was just called to show you information like your username on top, probably your cart information, and you probably didn't need this for browsing the books page at all. You could have just not called this service and somehow rendered the page, and it would have been better. So coming back to the points that I had mentioned earlier, designing for failures, did we do that? Of course, we did the first two because we had a timeout. Were we able to contain failures? We sent all the incoming requests were sent to the took more than 1 second, so we did not contain failures for the users. Every single user using that website was affected. Respect the service when it is slow. We didn't do that. We called service A for every single request that the application received. And finally, did we fail fast? No, I don't think so. Did we recover fast? This is very important here. So if you had 100 requests coming in at 1 second, and assume worst best case, you were able to serve 90 within that 1 second, and the next second again you got 100 requests, there are going to be 10 requests still in the pool, which means we are in this HTTP thread pool, we are going to add these 10 requests that we'll serve it later, and they are going to build up the queue with time. And what happens if your service is just down for, say, 60 seconds? So you'll have 60 into 10 requests as pending. That is 600 requests. And even if the user service comes up after that time, you need to process those 600 requests first. And this thing is called back pressure on your application. You're supposed to serve requests which came at an earlier stage instead of the ones that you're receiving now. So even the cases where your requests are coming in later are going to get affected. Now look at the circuit breaker mechanism. This is the normal case. What happened there? All requests went into that service. Now going to the circuit breaker analogy, circuit open would mean that, oh, we have an overload of on service A. So let's not send all requests. We send, say, a fraction of requests which timed out, and then we rejected all the requests directly. So it was short-circuited here and directly returned a response without waiting for the timeout. And as soon as the service comes back up, the circuit gets closed again. Now implementation detail, I'll explain in the next slide how this works. we have two thread pools here for each of the services, which are in addition to the application thread pool. How many threads would we keep for these thread pools? A very simple math we did here. This is a good starting point. We are serving 100 requests per second. Latency for the service is 100 milliseconds. So we use 10 threads for each of these pools. Again, let's analyze what happens when user service is down. Okay, user service is unavailable. Again, we got 100 requests into the pool. The first 10 requests which filled this pool are going to get timed out after 1 second. But because they occupied this pool, rest all of these requests are going to get rejected directly. So 90 of your 100 requests directly got rejected, and they did not need to call the user service at all. And the application keeps working as well as it can. So only 10 of your 100 users did get affected. Also, we'd want to know, okay, good mechanism, how fast can we recover with this? So we have 10 requests in this pool. Assume at the very next second, you got 100 more requests and user services back up. As soon as these earlier 10 requests get timed out and the next set of requests go into this pool, we'll go back into the happy case where the service thread pool is functioning as normally. None of the threads are blocked for timeouts, and we are going to call the user service as well. So how fast did we recover? As fast as 1 second. We did recover faster than 1 second, but for simplicity of math, we did recover within 1 second. So did we design for failures here? If you try to fill in all these gaps, yes, we did. I'll skip this slide. So if you try to fit in that model in all of these points, you would realize, yes, you did. So this is probably the most important slide in this, and probably how you would start in a real world. How would you test this mechanism? So before you actually build this mechanism and test it, you would actually want to know what issues are there in your application. So the way I started is using IP tables. Take one microservice at a time. See what happens when it fails. How do you simulate failures? So two simple examples here. IP address based dropping all incoming packets. So this is the IP address for the services. And we make Linux drop every single incoming packet. Similarly, if you know the port for the service and it's a unique port, drop every single incoming port. And finally, monitoring, once you have this mechanism in place, how many requests were rejected from this pool? If you remember, we had a rejection mechanism here. Majority of the requests are going to get rejected if there is a failure in the microservice. Why would you want to monitor it? In a happy case, this number should always be zero, because this would be how unoptimized your mechanism is and how many actual users got affected due to this. Yep, that's it. Thank you. So acknowledgements, Alex, he is my mentor. He has a lot more Twitter content than I do. You can go ahead with questions.
The time is up. Yep. So thanks, Kunal, for your presentation.
I'll be available here. So
yeah, Kunal would be available. You can ask questions offline.
Yep. Thank you. And the slides are here if you want the slides.